acceptance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, Mrs. Mayor, would you please call the roll?
I'd be happy to. Tim Manniker?
Here.
Gary Dunlap?
Here.
Tom Cruise?
Here.
Jeff Young?
Here.
Cheryl is excused. Anita Jagosinski?
Here.
And I'm here, and Lisa Collins?
Here.
All right.
All right, with six of the seven board members present, I will declare quorum. Approval of agenda. I would note that the agenda has been posted, distributed, and sent to the local media. With this in mind, are there any changes to the agenda? I would entertain a motion to approve the agenda as published.
I would so approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of motion to approve the agenda as published, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, signify by saying no. Motion passes. Public participation. Is there anyone who wishes to address the board relative to any item at this time? We would ask that a five-minute time limit per person be followed. Please state your name, address, and topic to be discussed. You can come up to the table and...
Okay. Good evening, Jim Schmidt. If my face looks familiar, I retired last year from the school system. So someone asked, said you look familiar.
And your address?
My address is North 2174 Bina Road, Coon Valley.
Okay.
I'm here to, my concern is the bids for the floor for the gymnasium. I was at the bid opening and there was four bids submitted. One of the bids did not have the cash bond in it. And it's my information right now, the school is still accepting the bid. And my concern is if we don't have to put a 5% cash bond in the future here, or where does it stand as to the issue of accepting a bid without the cash bond on it?
Okay, maybe Mr. Daly can speak to that.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, thank you. All right, anyone else? Okay, moving along. Recognition and thank you, Dr. Mueller.
Yeah, tonight I would like to, through the Donors Choose, a 105 nonprofit organization that allows individuals to donate money to classroom projects. They were at Prairie View Elementary, the kindergarten class was able to get a purchase of three iPad minis for Ms. Sodoko's class. So thank you for having that opportunity for those kids to have that.
Ms. Sodko.
Ms. Sodko.
It's my son's class.
Oh, did you get to see him use it in action?
No, I didn't even know that happened.
Oh, okay, so there you go. Thanks.
All right, thank you. And then district administrator's report.
Yeah. So I have a few items this evening. One is that very excited. We launched the new look and face of our district webpage. Greg Krieger, who is here with us this evening, our director of instructional technology, is very integral in this happening and working with Christina Kovacs to make that happen. And it's new, improved, and it's most compatible with mobile devices now. As to why we didn't move to going to an app, and right now the homepage is updated, and they'll be working over time on working on the building pages. One piece of that page, which I'm very excited about too, is right on the front page now, there's a place for people to report any safety issues or concerns, because as we heard at our last board meeting, there's things that we need to do and improve. So that was one thing that we're able to bring to the forefront. We also have our Holmen Middle School site plan has been being worked on and been in action. John Daly and Jay Clark have been working very hard with Ryan Vogler, our middle school principal, and many others. And so there's, at the last buildings and grounds meeting, they unveiled the plan for that site. And you'll be hearing more about that coming forward and seeing that actual plan. The part about that is they're able to fit two fields onto the grounds where there's only one right now, and they're going to do a little bit different look with the track, so they're still able to run some track, but then also put a walking path around the area. So that will fulfill, hopefully, the community needs and our school needs with our academics. When it comes to safety, we've been working really hard on what's called ALICE, and we have four employees now that are trained in that. Mr. Oberweiser, who is here, an elementary principal, Mr. Vogler, our middle school principal, and then Mr. Sackett, our high school principal, and Joe Hickey. And they went and got extensive training on this. And what it is it's just a different way to do a lockdown procedure. And right now, we're just learning about it. And in the up next week, they'll be going and working with all of our staff so that they can just be informed about what this is and what it would look like with training happening with staff in the beginning of the next school year. And so the parents will be getting some information on this in newsletters along with yourselves in the upcoming month in that. The one thing I do want to mention is we're kind of having a two-part series with health and safety. You know, health and wellness coming up. And one is at the high school in the Fine Arts Center on April 11th, Monday night, we're going to have an open session for any community members and, you know, business members too. Everyone's welcome. And just kind of talk about ALICE and what it is and how we're going to go about our implementation and so on and share that information on what that means for the district. And then we're in the process of arranging for working with some collaboration with some county services and so on to bring in some mental health kind of forum in May. So we're meeting again Thursday this next week and working on that so that we can start to build awareness around the Safe and Healthy Schools initiative. And then on April 22nd, we have our annual respect retreat at the high school. And I bring that up because any of the board members here, you're very welcome to join us for that day. It's a it's a very exciting day where all the juniors at the high school come together and basically we do games on communication and we talk about respect and what it means and how you practice how you go about it and so on. So if you're interested or any community members are interested, you can definitely contact the guidance office. Okay, so thank you.
Very good, thank you. And moving along to reports and discussion, high school gym floor replacement bid results, John Daly.
Good evening.
Good evening.
You should have had in your packet a bid summary sheet. And I will point out on that bid summary sheet, you'll note that the, as Jim indicated, the low bidder did not have a bid bond included with their bid. We did talk to them and ask them to send it to us, which they did the following day. And typically, you know, if they don't have a bid bond, we don't use their bid. However, this time we as we talked about this, we thought there are two very close bids with those two, and it would give us some flexibility. I am pretty sensitive based on the experience we had with our last gym floors, that I want to have the best people we can have, and I want to make sure of what we're getting and the timing is done right, and project gets done on time and is done in a quality manner. So this allowed me to, it has allowed me to make some references. I'm still continuing reference calls on both of those low bidders at this time. And we have to weigh that bid bond anomaly, I guess I'll call it, versus performance from the two bidders. And I will continue to check references out. I have I'm waiting for a number of calls to come back yet. I just got a list of some more references late last week. But before you, though, between those two bidders, they're only about $1,000 apart. We will bring you a recommendation to accept which one we would want to perform the job at the next board meeting when you approve this. Please note that this is not the total cost of the project. There are other costs involved, moving the bleachers in and out, fixing the bleachers, and raising the movable wall. So it's still going to come out to over $200,000. And again, Jay and I will spend some time in discussing the advantages or disadvantages of allowing a bid bond to come in late.
Any questions?
Do we have any history or experience of accepting a late bid bond on any other projects in the past?
I don't believe so. We do have it written in that in our advertising that the school board does reserve the right to accept or reject or waive all technicalities. This is what we consider technicality. I think it's still up to us to do this, but again, I think we really carefully have to think about if this is something we want to do just to set a precedent. And we need to think very carefully about that. At this time, based on what I've heard from, several references, I don't think I'd be uncomfortable with either one of them. Again, timing is a big thing for us. Make sure we get this gym floor done before volleyball season. I've been assured that the people who will work on the job do actually work for the company and won't farm it out to somebody else, as was the case the last time we had a gym floor put in. It was farmed out to somebody else who we really didn't know anything about. So I think we'll be, whatever we decide, we're going to be well taken care of by either of these companies.
Don't get cheap caulk, right?
Yeah.
Do we know why it wasn't included in the original bid?
They didn't tell me why. They had a letter on there from their lawyer saying that they are capable of having a bid bond, but they didn't have a bid bond in there.
I'm just curious. Because obviously it's an indication of attention to detail.
Yes. Yeah. And that's one of the things we talked about is if it came down to one against the other, that's one of the things Jay actually said. You know, it just tells us something about them that would weigh against them. Any other comments, Jay, or any thoughts? Okay.
Anyone else? Okay.
But we initially budgeted about $250,000. I think we'll be well under that with these bids. The other thing I wanted to check with both the contractors was that they knew that this was a white sheet project. If it's over so many dollars, they have to pay the prevailing wage, state wage. And they both said, yeah, they knew that. And so that was the first thing we thought when there was such a large gap between the bids, is maybe they didn't include prevailing wage in there, but apparently they did.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Phone system replacement and upgrade, Greg Krieger.
Our reasoning in placing this item onto your agenda this evening was to just give you a heads up that right now the district is operating with a very, very antiquated phone system that has had several major functional issues that have affected the district's ability to do business across this office building and some or all of the schools, depending on a specific incident you might reference. Getting the system up to date and functioning has been on the district's agenda for some number of years now, and it's something we'd like to bring forward at this point and send out to RFP and see what it will cost to get this done, and assuming it's within reason, move forward with that. In regards to the RFP, I put a copy into the Dropbox of a draft of the RFP and some of the questions that we will ask vendors who will bid on this. And it's going to be a very, very extensive process. It's a lot more than just asking a vendor to come lay down floor tile of a certain color, certain thickness in a room. There's many, many technicalities that go into the way it integrates with the network, the features and functions that the desk phones will have, various software that users will be able to run on their computers that work with the system, that let them listen to their voicemails, look up other users in the system. So instead of pigeonholing ourselves into a single vendor, and there's about four big players, manufacturers in this market, we have left it open but listed a lot of features that we would like, and we'll evaluate the bids that as they come in. In that light, the lowest bid numerically may not be the winner because it may not offer nearly the features that we would desire. But we at least have a comprehensive document to reference with these list of features, and we will lay out a grid of who is able to comply with what and determine a direction to head at this point in time. So with that, I just open the floor up for any questions.
Is this plan to come out of the technology budget?
Yes, it is.
Over the years, we've had pretty good discussions about whether telephones and the telephone system should come out of the technology budget or not, or out of the general fund. It's always been my feeling that it should come out of the general fund versus technology, because technology was intended to supply the students in the school with laptops and that type of technology, not telephones.
Yeah, and this would not touch that referendum allocation within technology, but as of now, the plan would be to fund this from the general technology budget. And part of that is supporting the operational needs of the district as we view it. Obviously, a huge portion of the technology department's mission is the specific education piece and supporting that as best we can. But the underlying business and operational needs are also a big element of making the organization successful.
Yeah, a question on the funding source, and I know you said it was coming out of the technology budget, and as I look at this, it's the 15-16 and 16-17 budget.
Yep.
Would the intent not to be to pay for it until the 16-17 fiscal year, or would you be looking to borrow short-term from the general fund?
In a perfect world, what would happen is if the bids come back in the timely manner we hope and we move forward with this project, we would buy the hardware and get it delivered here within this fiscal year, invoiced, and build out of this year's budget the professional services needed to get these systems configured and working would be completed in the next fiscal year and then invoiced in the next fiscal year.
So you wouldn't look to need to, like we're doing with the gym floor, kind of borrowing advance from the general fund and paying it back? It would not
essentially
be like
what
that.
We would do, each summer we would refresh a certain amount of the computers out in the district, and we will change that quantity based on how much we're going to need to take out of this year's budget and buy those later in summer out of the other budget. So that's how I would foresee it working.
And I'm certainly not disagreeing with that we need a new phone system at all, so don't take this comment that way. But I tend to agree with Gary here that I think one of the things that caused this to go to the technology referendum in the past was that so much of that budget, instead of going towards technology needs of the students, was other infrastructure.
Yeah.
Nice if we could find another way to do that and still accomplish what you're trying to do.
Any ballpark fee? What's it going to cost?
I don't want to put a number out there. I guess if I were to give a range, I would say it's going to be between $150,000 and $275,000. But in my past district, we went into this thinking minimally we'd spend $150,000, and then our successful bid was $88,000, and it worked out wonderfully. So I don't want to distribute writing saying, heads up, the district's looking to spend at least $200,000 on this, and then the vendors all bid that. So that's why I did not put numbers on the sheet there. But as a ballpark figure, I would say this will be in that range.
Seems like it'd be lower. It's not really high technology, just a phone, right?
When you talk about across 9 different buildings and all the auto attendants and ways people can access their voicemail and different direct dial numbers people have, it's quite a project to get it implemented.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I just have a question. So in years past, I think this was always needed, right? But it just kept getting pushed down the road.
Yeah.
So how many years ago should this have happened? And it doesn't mean we didn't make the right decisions. We had to put money elsewhere. But how long ago should this have happened? As you look at our history.
Well, one thing that I can speak to is, you know, I started in July. And I want to say within that first month, we had our phones were down and no one was able to reach us. And we were having problems with our phone systems between buildings and the communication. And it was not very good at all, because that put us in a very bad, not only safety issue problem, but the communication between, you know, families and schools and stuff, because we had some bad switches is what it was. So in the intern, we had some, we talked with different, the folks that we worked with, and they came to replace a switch, which wasn't as high quality as it should have been. So then we had issues again. So we talked with them and made sure they gave us the proper switch free of charge for the time being, but it still isn't a fix long term. And with a lot of other financial needs coming up in the future, if we're able to right now fiscally improve our phone system that was probably needed, and, you know, obviously before this last year even, that we came with this problem, that we want to do it while we can within the already allocated budget that we have. So
it sounds like once this is done, that's a really good thing, because then we're set for the next few years. I mean,
when was the last time I was on the board, I think, when we upgraded the phone?
It's been a long time.
I know Prairie, like there's, well, and this is the other thing, Prairie View, and you might have to help me, Greg, a couple of them are on VoIP systems and others aren't.
Prairie View is the only building right now that uses a VoIP system.
Yeah, so we don't even have the same systems working with each other, which makes it a little more difficult too, so.
Anyone else? Okay, all right. Thank you, Greg. Is fund balance and cash flow presentation, Julie Holmen.
And Jay Clark.
I'm here too. While Julie is bringing up the PowerPoint presentation, I'll do a little bit of an introduction. Julie and I are here tonight as your financial planners. Just as you might have a personal financial planner that would present to you and advise to you on personal finances, Julie and I are here to do the same on a school district level.
It's AV mute.
It was AV mute. I'm sorry. Turn it off.
He had it on standby. See this?
Right. He works some.
We can see it on our screen. We just need the rest to see.
He works some kind
just of. Just a minute.
Got a light
on it.
Thank you.
Okay,
that's what I do.
I see a light coming out. Thank you.
We'll have to invite Greg to come over and do a tutorial with me so that we aren't relying on him every time. So back to financial planning. So financial planners attempt to help their clients, and we attempt to help you achieve long-term fiscal goals, as well as maintain the district's fiscal sustainability. And this is best done by creating a common understanding and agreement on long-term goals, as well as how we'll measure our success in achieving those long-term goals. And also, like any good financial advisor, from time to time, we come back and report. And we report to you on how we're doing in achieving those goals and the outside forces that sometimes you don't have control over that impact your ability to achieve goals. So think of personal financing, and remember we had a recession and there were many people whose lives and long-term financial plans changed because of that. And that'd be an example in personal finances, like we have in school district, to respond to outside changes. And then sometimes when those forces from outside are profound, you have to recalibrate your financial plan and the targets you've set and how you'll achieve your goals. And so we're here tonight, again, as your financial planners, to help you and help this school district and community maintain fiscal sustainability. And Julie will go over the agenda and how we hope to accomplish this.
So tonight we're going to walk through why do we need to recalibrate the fund balance target, what has changed since the last time it was identified in 2011. A reminder of what is fund balance, help you understand what it is and the importance to have a fund balance, review the Board and Department of Public Instruction fiscal sustainability target, demonstrate the cash flow forecasting and support the recommendation to recalibrate the fund balance target percentage, and then we'll review some long and short-term solutions to resolve the current projected cash flow shortages.
So fund balance, what is this thing called fund balance? This is the school district of Holmen's results measure, fiscal sustainability results measure, titled fund balance. And fund balance alone isn't carry much meaning until you compare it to the annual expenditures we have. This is in fact one of our six district-wide fiscal sustainability measures. This measure has served us well in balancing both our short-term budget decisions with our long-term fiscal sustainability. Without such a target, you might get caught up in making some short-term decisions that don't serve you well long-term. You can see how we've set performance goal ranges. These are the red arrows shown. And how we've gradually improved our performance. By the way, Holmen is the blue line, to fall within those target ranges. This is working. We're using this as a guide to make sound fiscal decisions. The presentation tonight will describe how outside influences have created a need to revisit this fiscal performance goal, and it's specifically the ranges.
So what has changed since 2011? And why do we have to change the target? And what is there any harm in not making a change? We'll talk about those things. There's several things that have changed. One of them is the debt service reduction. So according to the debt service schedule, we've been paying down principal interest on the building bonds. As we pay down the debt service on the bonds, there's less money to lend to the general fund. The past practice of the district was to borrow internally from ourselves, from fund balance in another fund, and in this case it was through the debt service fund. There was a little extra in there, we'd borrow it, we'd send it back to meet that cash flow need while we were waiting for state aid or other revenue sources. In April of last year, the voters approved the referendum for technology, facilities, and transportation. That was approved without an increase to taxes. The way that was done, if you recall, was to offset the increase in the general fund taxes by a reduction in the debt service tax receipts. So last year when we approved the tax levy, we under-levied in the debt service fund in order to levy for the technology referendum in the general fund. This further reduces the debt service fund balance. Next, more recently, we have received DPI communication that discourages borrowing from another fund to meet operational cash flow needs. This information is new. In the past, we have borrowed from the debt service fund with authority from our auditors. It's been an approved practice. The recent communication has not been identified in statute, and so we are treating it as a recommendation. They are just discouraging internal borrowing from other funds. And lastly, the revenue pattern, as you'll see in the future, the cash flow forecast, and you've seen in the past, we receive our revenue from the state or the local levy at various times of year. DPI has deferred the per pupil categorical aid for this year until July. So instead of receiving that estimated $600,000 in March, according to statute, they deferred it through the legislative decision last year till July. So we will receive it in July, which is actually the next fiscal year. It'll become a receivable on the books, which means we won't have it in the form of cash in June to meet our cash flow shortage that you'll see on one of the graphs that will be coming up. Future legislative decisions to delay aid payments could also influence the forecast cash flow cycle.
So on that last one, understand the state had good reason to hold on to their money. They had cash flow issue too. And so what they said was, well, we'll hold our the revenue we receive another 4 months, which actually just transfers the cash flow challenge to the school district. But that was the intent they had behind their decision. It does transfer the burden to us, though.
Okay, so we talked about the why and the what has changed. Before we move on to fund balance, we just want to ask if there's any questions or clarify any understanding at this point.
Can I just ask about the DPI advice not to borrow from one fund to the other? So that's just a recommendation. Does that mean you'll follow their recommendation right now, or you're just listening and still?
For the end of our presentation, we'll give long and short-term strategies to meet cash flow. And to answer your question, one of the short-term strategies would be to continue as we have been, understanding that it is a recommendation that is out there.
And I'd like to add just a little bit, and Lisa, if I don't describe this, because we discussed this at the Finance Committee meeting tonight too. It is with good reason that the DPI makes that recommendation. What some school districts run into is they become very dependent upon these other sources, and then debt service dries up and they have not implemented any plan to address those resources no longer being available. And that plus some obligations you make when you have a bond issue, it's called an irrevocable tax levy, and there's an implication, not again a statutory requirement, there's an implication that you will not use that for other purposes. So there's a couple solid reasons why they'd recommend that. We think it's good advice, but as Julie will mention, sometimes when push comes to shove, you have to set aside the good advice for a little while until you find a long-term solution.
Thank you. Next, we will move on to fund balance. What is fund balance? It's really a formula. It's assets minus liabilities equals fund balance. The slide on your screen identifies the asset component. Cash and investments. This is an estimate for June 30th, 2016 distribution. And we estimate that cash and investments will be about $5.1 million of the estimated total assets of $11.4 million in June. Other assets in that $6.2 million line, those items include taxes receivable, state aid receivable, things due from other governments. So if we, if the state owes us money, like the categorical aid I just mentioned, that would be a receivable that we're waiting for. It's not cash that we can use to pay our bills or payroll. Other receivables at fiscal year end often include federal grant money, because federal monies always have to be spent up front and then it's on a reimbursement basis. And so those are always receivables at the end of the fiscal year. Additional other assets include prepaid expenses and other miscellaneous local receivables if we have invoiced for something and we're waiting for payment. Next, we subtract the liabilities from the total assets. Liabilities include accounts payable, so we've been invoiced for something, we haven't paid it yet. Again, fund balance is at a given point in time, and I'll get to a slide that explains it, but it is at June 30th when the audited fund balance is really the given point in time that we are reporting fund balance to the school board. On June 30th, we still owe for invoices that we received in June. So that is a liability. Additional liabilities would be like accrued salaries and other related items. Assets minus liabilities equals fund balance. The estimated fund balance with the current budget, 15-16, estimated fund balance for June 30th, 2016, is almost $10 million.
On that, it's okay that we went to this next slide, but the point is sometimes people confuse fund balance and cash. This slide is meant to illustrate the difference between the two. So yes, cash and investments is a component of what makes up fund balance, but the two are not one and the same. You can see here that the cash and investments is a substantially smaller number than fund balance.
So cash and investments is about 5.1 million. We often measure this as a percentage, the fund balance as a percentage of the expenditure budget. That refers back to the chart that Jay showed you on the second or third slide that's in the annual report, and that is how we measure it. So the estimated fund balance as a percentage of expenditures based on the current budget is 22.48%. So if you were to refer back to the target range, it falls into the current target range. Fund balance does change daily, and as I mentioned earlier, it is reported as of June 30th, or the last day of the fiscal year, when we have our audit. Any questions on fund balance? Okay, we'll move forward in the agenda and talk about the board and DPI fiscal sustainability targets. In 2011, the school board approved a target that calls for the annual June 30th fund balance as necessary to meet all current financial obligation without borrowing from other funds or outside lenders. At that point in time, the target was 21.5%. It was sufficient in 2011 and had been based on previous years' cash flow cycles. It's important to note, because of the fabulous growth in Holmen, our expenditure budget has gone up since 2011 by 11.5%. The targeted fund balance percentage of expenditures has not changed, which is one of the reasons we're coming to you tonight to explain why it may be necessary to increase that target. So the target remains at 21.5, but the expenditure budget has increased over 11% since 2011. Also in the annual report, these are some of the goals that target fund balance is supposed to meet. The goal would be to avoid short-term borrowing, generate recurring revenue, accumulate sufficient assets, and demonstrate financial stability, therefore preserving and enhancing the bond rating and lowering future debt issuance costs. Next is the Department of Public Instruction guidance on fund balance. DPI agrees with the board. It's an amount sufficient that short-term borrowing for cash flow could be avoided and would also allow the district to set aside sufficient assets to realize its long-range goals. Notice the common theme of avoiding short-term borrowing.
So the question might be, does our current target match the stated objectives? Well, that's a rhetorical question, and it says if no. The answer is no, it does not. So the point is, you shouldn't state objectives and then not intend to meet them. So we need to either change the objective to match where we're at currently, or change the target to match what we've stated is our objective. The administrative recommendation, the two of us, your financial advisors, I think I can include Chris in that as well, is to align the target that we set for ourselves with the stated objectives. Make sense? So the target was 21%. The stated objectives was no short-term borrowing from other funds or external sources. So 21% won't do that anymore. Then the question becomes, well, how are we going to reset the target? And Julie, Jay's still talking about that. So remember when we talked about assets and we shared this slide earlier? As you can see here, cash and investment represents the largest asset amount for the district. And remember the formula, assets minus liabilities equals fund balance. The only viable way then to increase fund balance is to increase the cash and investments. The other numbers are not going to change. For this reason, we now turn our attention to the issue of cash balance and how it affects fiscal sustainability, and then ultimately the fund balance itself.
If there aren't any questions, we'll move on to the cash flow forecast. PMA is our public financial advisor. They help us with debt planning, other forecasting for budget, and more recently, we have engaged them in cash flow projection. This chart on the screen begins in June of 2015, so the beginning of this school year and school district fiscal year, and takes you through to December of 2016. The cycle repeats itself pretty much annually for this district because we tend to, it doesn't change that much, how much we get from levy versus how much we get from aid. And aid payment is identified in statute when we receive those dollars. If you notice, just to the left or right of center is the red part of the chart. The green bar is $1 million, and the $1 million is the targeted liquidity, and that's the recommendation by our financial advisor. So the beginning of that drop in June is still in a positive cash flow situation, but it's dropping below the $1 million liquidity target. Once it goes below the green bar, we are at zero, which means we are cash flow, we're cash deficient to meet our obligations about June 17th. I don't know if you can see that on the screen, but it says 1.7 million, June 17th, 2016. It's also a very short amount of time, less than 30 days. It's actually in the middle of June where it's anticipated, based on our history of accounts payable and payroll, that we will have a cash flow shortage for a couple weeks in June.
Before we go on, so anywhere you've got a yellow, that's adequate cash on hand to meet current obligations. When the line drops and it starts intersecting with the green bar, that means you've fallen below $1 million in cash available to meet needs. And then when it goes below the green bar, red, well, it was red in the green bar, but red, that means you actually don't have enough money on hand to pay your current bills. And so that's what this is illustrating. Julie, did you mention at the top it says this does not include or less debt service? This is not new, this pattern here. In the past, we have used debt service as a way to borrow from our own, or in your personal finance, it'd be where you had the money escrowed for your mortgage. We've been borrowing from that to help meet this cash flow need. And we can continue to do that on a short-term basis that would not be consistent with our long-term stated objective. We should have enough, and the DPI recommendations, we should have enough money in our checking account, our general fund account, to meet our bills in our general fund account.
Any questions on the cash flow forecast? One thing I wanted to say about this is it is based on history. I give them statements, banking statements every month so they can update it. But there's so many variables as well. If we have accounts payable, if we have invoices coming in that we weren't expecting at that time, I'm just thinking of Greg's presentation on paying for the phone equipment before the end of the fiscal year. You know, that may be not included in the projection. We try to give them all the information we know at this time, all the projected expenses for that matter. When this chart was created, I already knew that John was going out for a gym floor bid and that we would have an anomaly, something coming up this summer that we wouldn't have had in our history, $250,000 potentially, that would impact our accounts payable at that time that wouldn't have shown up if we only used the history. So we try to include all those projected expenses as well so they can build them into the forecast.
Can I just ask a clarifying question though on the, in those couple of red areas, the May, June, you know, in the red, and then the November in the red? Those are areas that if we don't do something, meaning supplement this, that there are some things that have to be paid during that time, correct? Like sure. Salaries and things like that.
Yeah. Addressing this issue by deferring expenditure is not a very viable option. So
it's not like we can, it's not like we owe Reinhardt Foods a right. bill for food services.
Largest portion of our budget is in our salaries and benefits, and those are not expenses that you would choose to tell employees, give us another 30 days and we'll take care of that. That's what they depend upon for their living expenses. An IOU, in effect, which is what we got from the state, which I'm not sure I want to pass on any further.
Going to move on to recalibrating fund balance. So this chart, the yellow is what you've already seen tonight, the estimated distribution June 30th. And as Jay mentioned earlier, the only viable option would be to increase cash because we don't have influence over the other things. We don't have influence over receiving state aid payments earlier or taxes earlier than we receive them currently. So adding $1.7 million to cash and investments would increase the asset by $1.7 million. Liabilities remaining the same at $1.4 million. Assets minus liabilities is fund balance. Fund balance would be increased then by $1.7 million. If we were to have the ability to do that, the percentage of expenditures then would increase from 22.48 to 26.31%.
That percentage then might be a new target aligned with the stated objectives that we have as a school district.
Did I go too far? I'm sorry. I'm looking at two things. There you go. Ignoring the blue bar, because we tried to overlay these to represent an increase in the cash and investments asset by increasing by $1.7 million. So the black line was the forecast that I showed you previously from PMA showing the dip in November, June, and November again. And the blue line on the top represents increasing by $1.7 million to avoid going below zero and meeting our cash flow need without internally or externally borrowing.
So that blue squiggly line on top represents lifting the whole chart by $1.7 million. So when you lift the whole chart, you lift those dip points above the zero line. It looks like they're red, but that's just the red from what was. They actually would not be in the red at that point in time. That's what recalibrating to 26% would do. And you can see how that would remedy then the short-term borrowing.
Any questions on this chart?
I will, but I'll save them for the end.
Sure?
Yes.
Okay.
Because they may answer my question.
So, that's what they kept doing.
We did have that at the Finance Committee, too, didn't we? So, long-term solutions. So just like with a personal financial planner, you better first of all define long-term, because when you're 30 years old, retirement long-term means something different than when you're 50 years old, and what's long-term for retirement. And so we're trying to define long-term by looking at some meaningful events for the school district. Julie mentioned earlier the importance of fund balance as a percentage of expenditures in determining the district's fiscal rating, bond rating. So just like we all have a score that's used by bankers to determine what kind of loans we might qualify for, what kind of interest rates, so too does a school district. It's called the Moody's rating. And one of the major factors that goes into that rating is the district's fund balance, and specifically fund balance as a percentage of expenditures. If we have a low rating, when we go out to bond, the interest rate you'll pay, we all, as members of this community, will pay, will be much higher, which will mean more taxes, and when you're presenting a building referendum, a higher cost associated with the project. So we're looking at the next project we might have, and based on current enrollment and facility capacity, in 2023, we would project needed occupancy of a middle school. Middle school space is projected to be exceeded at that point in time. If we're going to occupy the building in 2023, we'll be selling the bonds in about 2021, because you need to have the money about 2 years ahead of time to pay for the construction of that school. If we're going to sell bonds in 2021, the financial statements we'll be looking at will be from the year before that, 2020. So you see how we've backpedaled from when we need to have this good bond rating to the year that they're going to look at to determine our bond rating. And that's 2020. So if we're going to target long-term when we should get ourselves in the target aligned with the objective, it would be that year. So that's 4 years is the length of time to achieve the long-term target. Did I say that all right?
So I'm going to review some short-term solutions, and then we'll talk about the summary of the four-year. So as we have been doing in the past, we would plan to short-term borrow internally from the debt service fund, beginning with the 2016 debt tax proceeds. So we've received the January and February property tax payments, and rather than distributing them to the debt service fund, we will plan to use them in the operating fund for cash flow purposes. And then as soon as we have that June 17th state aid payment, we would transfer the debt service receipts to the proper fund. We also have debt service fund balance that last year, the audited June 30th debt service had a fund balance that was based on years of debt defeasance practices in the district. There's still some debt service fund balance. We can access those funds as we've done in the past for a short term, again, probably less than 2 weeks. To borrow from ourselves, and then with that in the past, we have distributed the interest that fund would have earned if it had its receipts in the proper place at the time. So we transfer both what we borrowed plus interest to the debt service fund. Lastly, the short-term solution would be external interest borrowing, and by short-term, I'm not talking about June, I'm talking about the next couple of years when we potentially will not have the resources to borrow internally from ourselves, yet we haven't grown the fund balance to meet the operational cash flow needs in June and November. may require external borrowing through either a short-term loan or a line of credit. And that may also include an increase to our request in October during the annual meeting. So currently, the board has approved up to $1 million in short-term borrowing as part of the annual meeting process based on future cash flow forecasts. We may have to request that that short-term borrowing maximum be raised and so that we can meet the June or November cash flow need until we can grow fund balance to meet it internally.
And actually that, while the board has supported, as members of the community, the $1 million authority to borrow short-term, that's actually something we've asked our community. Remember that happens at the board, the annual meeting. And so it's not only the board that has a voice in that, but the community as well. So we would need to educate them at the point in time if that amount needs to be increased from $1 million. So back to the long-term strategy, understanding what long-term is and how we're going to get through the interim period. So if the old target is 21.5% and the new target is approximately 26%, and we're looking to get to that target by June 30th, 2020. And the annual increase to the fund balance would need to be in the neighborhood of $400,000 to $500,000. It's just too much to try to accumulate in a budget our size in any shorter cycle. And you understand why 4 years is an important timeline. And I think Dr. Mueller made some comments at the Finance Committee meeting about why it was important for us to share this information before we approve a preliminary budget for 2016-17. And I don't know if you wanted to add comments on.
Well, I just want us to have as much information possible as we need, as we think down the road as to our budget and approving our preliminary budget and so on. I've always liked to be safe and be able to have flexibility if we have extra funds, depending on what we get in our aid and so on, versus finding that we fall short and having to figure out what we need to cut, you know, in my philosophy and so forth. I guess is kind of where I was going with it. You know, the other point that I don't know if they mentioned or talked about is, you know, as our membership increases slowly, so say we get, for example, we could get $1 million more next year in revenue, or our revenue limit could go up. If that would happen, you know, putting 400 or 500 aside before we say what are we going to spend the extra dollars on or where are they needed would be a strategy that could help in this without having any cuts, because it'd be hard to cut from, because we're, you know, running right now on what we can run on. It'd be hard to go in and make cuts to what we have going on right now. But it's basically the money that would be coming in, what way would we want to spend it is kind of the thinking. So
Mr. Mettinger, I know you were itching to ask a question.
Yeah, could we go back to that first PMA slide that had the $1 million liquidity and had the 15, 16, 17? I had a couple of questions on that slide. As we look at the information on the bottom, and it kind of fell off from there, but it looks like that $1.7 million gap is for fiscal year 2016. That gets smaller in 2017 and goes away in 2018. Is that factoring in this plan already, or is that pre this plan? Because as I look at this, it's that 1.7 million is one time this year. It gets smaller in 2017 and goes away altogether in 2018.
Yeah, I can explain a bit
and
of the 2017.
So I'm looking at that going, do we really need to increase it by that much when it's one time this year for a couple of weeks? Next year it's smaller, in 2 years it's gone altogether.
The in part of the answer, maybe Julie can fill in the rest. In 2016, At least 600,000 of that is this what's been identified as a one-time deferral, 4-month delay, I should say, in that categorical aid. We don't anticipate that happening again in the future, although it demonstrates a willingness and pattern to solve state problems by passing them on to school districts. So right now, that does not perpetuate. Could it be something in addition to that? It could be. This is a bit of a moving target, Tim, and so just as we're back reporting to you tonight, we would need to annually report on this and say, okay, we said 400 to 500. Has the target changed as well as we've made progress on it? So it may not end up being 1.7. We're presenting to you tonight based on the fact that that's the scenario we face today. Julie, is there more that went into that long-range forecasting?
No, not that I know of. That's the only one that we knew for sure that was a delayed payment.
If we do nothing, we won't have a gap at all in 2018.
Well, is 2018 when we get that extra $100 per pupil, and then the next year we don't know?
No, FY17, so next year is when we get
next year.
Tim, it's a fair point, Tim. I can't answer that question tonight. Yeah. I can't answer what were all the variables that went into 2018. I can speak to 2017. Julie'd have to go back and see what PMA was. The chart doesn't even illustrate out that far, so I don't know what was included.
I mean, I certainly understand needing to pay our bills and all that. I just don't want to overdo over a one abnormal number and have an overreaction because there's one number that's outside of the norm. When, you know, one of those very first charts shows that we already as a district have a higher percentage of fund balance than the MVC and state average. So we're already high. To take that up even higher yet would be.
I'd agree with your first point. I take difference with your second point because each school district's cash flow is somewhat different.
Mm-hmm.
And while we keep that data set for some bit of comparability, I wouldn't lock what Holmen does as fiscally sustainable to what Onalaska or La Crosse does. But I agree on your first point. We need to keep track of this and not be trying to solve a problem that doesn't exist. We talked about, back to the personal financial advisor analogy, they say 6 months wages, right? Mm-hmm. So that you can face challenges should they come up. Why would you go to a year? Do you need to go to a year? What are you giving up to go to a year? And so we do the same type of thing here as a district. We want to achieve fiscal sustainability, but don't take it any further than that because really you begin to hurt your immediate financial effectiveness.
And I just know how hard it is, you know, every year when we look at those budget numbers to continue to do that. I mean, the unfund needs, and then to say we're going to take another $400,000 or $500,000 a year, and basically this is an extra expense, is going to be very difficult.
We've often talked at this board level about fiscal discipline, and it takes a tremendous amount of discipline to do something like this when you're faced with lots of needs.
Mm-hmm.
Tim, I would like to add that even if the 1.7 is unusual, we have been borrowing from the debt service fund. Prior to my coming to Holmen, there's history of borrowing internally from our debt service fund. And as we pay off and near the completion of that debt service schedule, this annual pattern will continue, but we won't have the fund balance and debt service to draw from to continue under the past practice. So to some extent, there's still going to be a need to short-term borrow for cash flow when that debt service fund balance is depleted or until another bond issuance allows us to do future debt defeasance and grow a debt service fund balance. So 1.7 may be unusual, but the annual pattern recurs, and I would estimate that we won't have the savings account or the escrow account to use for that short-term borrowing as we pay off those bonds.
We will look into those numbers for 2018 and beyond, though. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else? Questions?
I just want to say that we had a good two-hour meeting, and there's, these guys are working really hard, I think, trying to get, come to some solutions, so. Outside the box, so.
Yeah, we just want to, I just make one last comment. We just want to make sure that when it's time to build in, as we know, we're growing, you know, at a steady rate, in that we're able to go out and get good rate for our projects. Because we, you know, if we plan now, and I really think you make a good point, you know, maybe this is something we look at quarterly. Well, they're always watching it, but maybe share at certain points in time just to keep a close eye on so that we know when we go out, we'll get a good rate, because that's what saves us the money in the long run, you know. So we're just trying to be very responsible and plan ahead. So thanks.
And I appreciate your patience. Maybe even I call it endurance. I know finance things aren't necessarily right.
Thank you.
Right.
And then next is health insurance plan options. And it says Julie.
And we're going to be joined by Janice Wabra, I believe.
Here, let me grab another.
I'm sure this people are tight.
Yeah, buckle up.
Buckle up.
Maybe this is where that savings will come from.
Yeah.
Try and keep. Julie.
So things that are review, we're going to go through quickly. You've seen this before. Here we are, March 28th. Presenting to the board the options for the health insurance plan renewal for next year. We would come back pending your comments at the April 11th meeting to get your approval to proceed with the options as presented. This next slide. 4 years ago, we met with staff to learn what was important to them as we looked at health insurance. And we matched that with what was important to the district. So we had a joint understanding moving forward on what we would look to do with health insurance. Those things in green were identified at the time as those items we had not only mutual interest in, but were doing well on. Those things in red were areas for improvement. Note under cost, the lowest premiums possible was a joint item that we agreed we were not doing very well. This next slide shows a history of the school district's change from 2012-13 school year through 2014-15. Remember that in 2014-15 was the first year that the district actually offered dual choice plans. We offered two different plans to employees of the district. At that point in time, another change we made was that the premium paid by the district was defined by the lowest cost plan. Prior to that, it was a defined, I always get that mixed up, defined benefit versus defined contribution. It was a defined benefit. Prior to that, it's a defined contribution plan starting in 2014-15 and is yet today. The next slide represents what was taking place in 2015-16. This year, you can actually see we added a third plan design. Lisa, I should have asked. Give one of those to Jeff, please. And then I made copies. Some of these numbers are really small and hard to read, so I had made copies for the board members. We've always tried to be transparent as we've moved through our changes in health insurance by sharing with the staff and community what our plan direction is for future years. On this slide, we show for 2017-18, the plan is to pretty much duplicate what we're moving to in 2016-17. That is three plans. I would add that the plan to design would be dependent upon the number of continuing participants. Remember, we've said in the past, it's our intention to discontinue a plan when we have less than 10% of those eligible people participating in the plan. So So that is one change that is possible, even though we have not eliminated the plan in 2017-18 on this.
Which one is this? Plan two?
Plan two. Right, currently we're showing that as a direction, but if participation should fall below 10%, that's a plan that could be discontinued. Janice.
Okay, thank you. Some of the things that we discussed throughout the years with regard to the employee benefits, what is driving up the cost of the, primarily we're focusing on the health insurance plan. Under the Affordable Care Act, there are what are referred to as reinsurance fees, which are 3% of the total premiums. And those fees are a fixed fee, and they really are funding the Affordable Care Act. There's cost involved with Medicaid and Badger Care, so those are components that we cannot control. There's medical trend, and that's really keeping up with technology in our community. The cost of care, prescription drug, new medications that are new on the market, and then different treatment programs. The demographics, meaning the age and gender of a group, do have an impact on rate projections. As we mature in age, they look at the higher claims based off age. So that does have a bearing on the projections by an underwriter. And also the loss ratio. When an underwriter looks at the risk of a group, they'll actually go back and look at 3 years of health claims, meaning premiums versus claims, to define what kind of risk factors or the trend of a particular group.
And I'd remind the board that the one of these variables that we have the greatest ability to impact is the loss ratio. As Janice pointed out, what happens at the federal and state level, we little impact. Medical trend, little impact. The demographics, we are not going to start hiring based on age and gender to control our health insurance premiums. So what we're left with is the loss ratio. And many of the plan design changes we've made in the last 3 years, as well as the introduction of the wellness program, are intended to get at that variable.
This slide represents the average cost per employee from the school district, and this is a calendar year cost for 2015 versus the norm. And this is just strictly the numbers presented for 2015. The dark blue represents the employee, the red is spouse, the green are dependents, the teal is the admin stop loss, and the darker shade of teal or light or green would be the pharmacy. So depending on the colors, I know they vary between the slides and what we're looking at the projector, so I apologize for the color combinations, but it does truly show the difference between the average cost per employee versus the norm, and there's a 35% difference average between what the employee cost is for 2015 to the norm. The next slide actually represents a trend line, which is the green line that goes through about the middle of the screen. And this shows the average cost per employee from 2011 through 2015. You can see that the average cost per year has exceeded the norm. So when we talk about making plan modifications and trying to create more consumerism, we definitely see there is a need to be able to do that. Not only based off plan designs and consumerism, but I think the wellness components that are being designed and developed throughout the district on the wellness programs, I think will have an impact as well as we continue to monitor the claims for the district. This slide represents the health and RX claims for 2013. I want to show you that the next couple of slides, the reports that we receive are based off a calendar year. So it's a 12-month cycle from January through December, even though sometimes our plan years are going to run on a different 12-month cycle. So for comparison purposes, this slide shows the 2013, the premiums and claims and the loss ratio per month. The green highlighted line for September is where we actually made a plan change, September 1st of 2013. This rough slide represents the actual changes that were made September 1st of 2013. We still only had one health insurance plan as of September 1st of 2013, but at this point we were aligning all of the employees to be covered under the same plan and trying to align it to be on the same 12-month cycle, which our goal, if you can recall a couple years ago, was to align all of our plans for a July 1st not only our health insurance plan, our flex plan, so, and everything would be on the same 12-month cycle for the employees in ease and administration and understanding. So as of September 1st of 2013, we increased the deductibles, we increased the maximum out of pocket. However, we added the health reimbursement arrangement plan, which is a dollar amount that is paid by the district to help reduce the out-of-pocket exposure for the employees, both for singles and for families. That plan change reduced for the plan year the loss ratio from 123% to 85%. This slide now adds the 2014 calendar year claims, premiums versus claims, and also reflects the loss ratio per month and for the year. The green line represents aligning all of the benefits for July 1st, and that's where we made a plan change as well. So from July 1st going forward in 2014, our renewals have followed a plan year renewal. So that's the green line reflects on this particular slide. So what happened July 1st? We added two plans. In the past, we had one plan. This is when we introduced a second plan. So the employees had choice of plan one and plan two. So plan one was referred to as status quo. Plan two increased the maximum out of pocket. We kept the same deductible, but we increased the maximum out of pocket for single and for family. We added two levels for the office visit. We had a $25 for primary and a $50 for specialist. We also added a chiropractic treatment plan for plan two only. And the reason we introduced this is that our chiropractic services well exceeded the norm, and we felt there was a need to engage a chiropractor with a treatment plan for our members. By making this plan, all plans plan your loss ratio changed from 85 to 83. This slide now adds the 2015 data for the calendar year. Again, the green line reflects the renewal for July 1st. And it shows overall the loss ratio for 2015 was at 96%. This slide now breaks down the premiums by claims for plan one, two, and three. As you remember, I indicated as of July 1st of 2014, we introduced two plans. So if you'll notice for the top portion here for plan one and two, from January through June, we had two plans. And we introduced a third plan referred to in all the communications with the employees as Plan 3, which started July 1st of 2015. So we have tracked the premiums and the claims separately for each plan so we could monitor which plans are running well and which ones that we knew that were probably not going to be sustainable based off claims versus premiums. So as of July 1st of 2015 is where we introduced a third plan. Plan number one was pretty much status quo, other than we had to add a prescription copay maximum out of pocket. And this was partly because of the Affordable Care Act, where copays now have to apply towards a maximum out of pocket. And we adjusted the urgent care copay from 20 to 25. The average urgent care visits in our community are running about $220, so we need to align that appropriately. Plan two, pretty much status quo from the previous year. Again, we added the cap on prescription copays. We adjusted the urgent care copay as well. Plan three was the new plan that was introduced July 1st of 2015, where we actually increased the deductible and the maximum out of pocket. Some of the feedback we had received from the employees is they really wanted to have less financial costs, meaning their premium deductions, and would have more liability without a pocket exposure. So by introducing Plan 3, we have the deductible increased from $500 to $1,000 for single, for family from $1,000 to $2,000. The maximum out of pocket went from $1,500 to $2,500 for single, and two times that for family, the same urgent care copay adjustment, and also with the health reimbursement, we modified the health reimbursement plan to reimburse the second half of the deductible. So that was a positive impact for the employees they'd elected to go to the new plan three. All plan years with the loss ratio by making this change went from 83 to 103. So you're saying, why did we do that? But if you remember on the previous slide when we broke down the loss ratio between plan one, two, and three, plan one's loss ratio for the whole year was at 197%. Plan two was at 93%. And plan three, it was at 36%.
Stay on that slide for just a minute, Julie, because think about that. Remember, the only thing we can affect is the loss ratio. What do you think is going to happen with the premium in plan one when they had a 197% loss ratio over the full year? And then I'm going to ask you to look even more closely because the subtotal there, which shows from July to December, what is that number? 486%. That means for every dollar we paid in premium, they paid out in claims almost $5. No insurance company is going to survive on that very long. In fact, they'll increase the premium to recover and put themselves in a position where we can't sustain plan one. Yep. And if you look at the number of dollars in premiums that are paid, you can see how people have migrated away from plan one. Because if you look at the monthly premiums, and there was an adjustment in there we had to do in November, but look at cumulatively what the premiums were paid. That's illustrative of how many people have moved out of plan one because they too recognize that the premiums that have to be paid to make that plan work are awfully high. They're migrating to plan two and plan three. You can see that by the premiums paid in those other plans prior to July 1st and after July 1st.
That's what I was going to add, is the migration from the different plans once we introduce the third plan July 1st.
Now, I would say plan three is being underutilized. If you look at the premiums there, and we've had discussions with people throughout the year that on this renewal, a number of the people who are in plan two say, I really should be in plan three. They were just more secure staying with what they had. I think we'll see a migration to plan three.
So they're...
I'm going to just interrupt here, sure. Janice, because this presentation on top of the prior one, again, I appreciate your attentiveness. This slide is a match other than the waiver of premium from what we presented in January. So let's just talk about that one item on the bottom of the screen.
The additional that Jay is referring to is the waiver of premium. And what that is somebody goes out on disability. There's a waiver of premium rider that's a part of the health insurance plan. So if the member is on a long-term disability claim, they have a waiver of premium up to 30 months. And that's based off the plan that they are enrolled in the time that the waiver started. So because we have had a number of people on the waiver premium prior to the introduction of plan two and three, they're on plan one, which is our highest cost plan. So that has skewed, I think, some of the numbers that are a part of plan one. And so therefore we recommend that the proposal would be that the employees that are on waiver premium would be moved to the lowest cost health plan as of July 1st or at the time they become eligible for the waiver premium.
So that is one change. Remember we said in January when we were here we were going to go back and evaluate our current plan design and the utilization of that plan design and come back with any recommendations for change. That's a change we'd recommend incorporating into our plan design. And I don't believe the recommendations for plan design changes are any different than they were in January. So we've provided that for you again, so you don't have to go back and look for it in January. But we're not going to spend any time going over it because it's not changed. How about the next slide? Same thing with slide 20. Same thing, that's the same as it was. Here's something new.
This slide represents other districts in the community that currently have HSA compatible plans. As we've discussed, we'd like to add a plan four, and that is an HSA compatible plan. And there are other districts in our community that have HSA plans, and they've had them for a number of years. And the one thing I also wanted to point out is these particular districts only offer one plan. We still want to be able to offer the employees choice, so that they can have a traditional health plan. Is that where their comfort level is? and also introduce the HSA plan. We've had a number of employees through the years have asked for an HSA plan. Either they understand the value of them, or they've come from a different district that had an established HSA plan. So this just shows you four other districts that are in the community or in the area that currently have HSA plans. I thought it was important to share that information with you. At the bottom reflects their current premiums, that's prior to their renewals, and then if there is an HSA contribution made by the district, the dollars amount, and also when those deposits are made. I also wanted to share with you some private sector clients that have HSA plans, and some of the clients offer dual, meaning they offer a traditional plan and an HSA plan, but also some of them are strictly an HSA plan only. And there are private sector employers that do not contribute to an HSA. They still have the HRA with their HSA component type plan. So the school districts that I work with do make an HSA contribution. They eliminate the HRA, but the private sector, some of them do a combination of both. So we wanted to share you both information from school district's perspective and also the private sector.
People often ask how we compare,
right,
both other school districts and private, so we thought we'd include that information. The next slide is a bit busier than it was when we were here in January, because at that time we had eliminated Plan 1 but shown only one version of Plan 4. Here you see Plan 4 Option 1, Option 2, and Option 3, and you can see the varying co-insurance and maximum out-of-pocket? No, just the maximum out-of-pocket amounts associated with each of these. The board's given us a directive, marching orders, if you will, on the budget for 2016-17. Do y'all remember what the health insurance premium increase net effect's supposed to be? Zero, goose egg. And we don't know what the bids will come in on this Plan 4 design. So what we're asking for is proposals on three different options for Plan 4. And we're bound and determined to deliver the best benefit package we can to our employees, yet still adhere to the board's wish to have a zero increase in the health insurance premium area. So you can see what we're saying to you is, if you're going to approve us going out and getting plan design proposals, prices, we need to have some flexibility because we don't know exactly what the premiums are going to come in on these plans. Does that make sense? We just need to have some options to work with. And we're sharing with you, and we'll share with the employees up front what kind of options we're looking at. This is a work in progress, this slide. Our employees deserve to know what would the impact be in terms of their take-home wages, wages in pocket, based upon the health insurance plans we offer. And so, again, we're staying with the color coding, and what we're saying is on the left-hand column, column one, for the current plan, what's the employee premium amount per year? And then what we do is in the remaining columns say, okay, if you're plan one now, left-hand column, single, the annual premium amount is $5,052. Next year, what if you go to, what if you stay in plan one? Oh, you can't, it's not available, NA. Well, what if I go to plan two and the premium estimated above, you can see would be $3,165. That employee would have $1,887 more in take-home pay because of the drop in the premium contribution. And you can do that for any other employee too. If I'm on plan two now and I stay on plan two, well, I'll have $1,317 less because of the increase associated with remaining on that plan. But if I'm on plan two and go all the way over to the right, plan four premium actually comes in at $1,305 employee contribution. You see, I end up with $543 more in my pocket. Does that make sense? So what we're trying to do is create a quick reference for employees to look at and say, okay, I'm on plan two now. what's the financial impact to me in terms of net pay if I choose another plan design? And you can see anybody going to plan four saves money, and anybody on plan one currently saves money. You see how that works? These aren't real numbers. We don't know what the premium increases are going to be for plan two and plan three for next year. Although when you look at the loss ratio information, I think you can kind of guess what's going to happen with plan two. But we're going to get the information and then provide this type of chart to employees so they can understand what the personal impact is. Now, one thing that's not shown here is if you go from plan two or plan three to plan four, we're planning on increasing what is the HRA contribution amount. If you go to plan four, we're actually going to not only make it an HSA, which has its own advantages, but we're going to increase the dollar amount. So you receive more money in that HSA to cover any deductible or out-of-pocket expenses you have. That's not shown on here, but that's real money to an employee. We're just trying to keep it simple and focus on the premium contribution with this chart.
All right, I get the last, I think it's the last slide, mm-hmm. other than questions. But this slide was presented in January. As Jay mentioned earlier, the budget input variable for employer cost health insurance premium was zero. And as presented in January, the effort to get to zero is a premium decrease by adding plan four. This would also decrease what the district's currently paying into HRA coinsurance, because if people migrate to plan four, they would be getting an HSA benefit rather than an HRA benefit. And so we have decrease in premium, decrease in HRA coinsurance, decrease in HRA second half of the deductible, which is the plan three HRA benefit, but an increase in the employer contribution to an HSA benefit in plan four. These numbers are created based on estimated migration, and we've used past migration numbers to try to estimate how many of our participants will move from either plan one, two, or three into plan four in order to achieve the zero impact in employer cost.
So this is just for presentation report discussion tonight. We would come back at the next board meeting to have the board authorize pursuing this, presenting to employees and getting premium quotes.
I'm just curious, with Janice, right?
Yes.
Is there any restrictions with HSAs and with the Affordable Care Act if you're not a big entity? I just can't, for some reason, I think my wife is talking about that because we're self-employed, and I was just wondering, was there any kind of restrictions with if you in that with
there's a minimum deductible that you can have, which is $1,300 and $2,600 for single and family. There's a maximum out of pocket that the deductible coinsurance and maximum out of pocket exposure can be, and also there is an HSA contribution limit, and those numbers, all three, are adjusted each year.
That's a very good point. That one of the reasons it took us so long to get to an HSA plan was because we were so far away from it 3 or 4 years ago. And the approach that the district took and the board supported was to gently migrate towards this type of plan design, create options, but make the choice to go to a more expensive health insurance plan be borne in part by the employees. So we didn't just jump right to HSA because it was a bit of a leap to get there.
Anyone else questions?
Thank you very
much. Oh, I had a quick question.
Sorry.
You don't need to think about this more because I'm kind of finance committee out right here, but is there any way to do an incentive for people that maybe choose a plan that has a higher premium, higher deductibles? They stay in network, they use community clinics, they preventive care, primary doctor scheduling, you know, versus walk-in clinic, you know, urgent care kind of thing, at the end of the fiscal year to compensate them back for that as a reward. Because if they're not, do you know what I'm saying? If the loss is low with certain members under certain plans, would there be a possibility to have a reward of some sort?
That's actually embedded right within an HRA and an HSA plan design, because specifically with an HSA, if you make those proactive choices and try to manage the cost, the HSA contribution you get, you keep. If you find ways to go to the neighborhood family clinic and avoid any claims cost at all, or any participation by, you get to keep the money. And in fact,
that's money that you set aside for your health care, or that?
Right.
So you're setting aside your own money for your health care.
That's all you can use it for, too.
No, but they're saying you get it.
Right.
Are you saying that you get to keep it then?
The employee keeps the HSA contribution.
If they don't use it for their health care, you're saying this is the one you're talking about, HR, is different than the one they're talking about.
An HSA is a combination. It can be of employer and employee dollars. So the district, the way the plan that we've looking at for plan four is the HSA dollars are employer dollars. That is accumulation of the deposit plus the wellness dollars that we'd like to put into that account as well. And then the employee can put their own dollars into that account.
Okay.
So what I have seen with HSA type plans, the neighborhood family clinic or the community care clinic are a good option because they can utilize those two clinics mm-hmm. at no mm-hmm. expense
right.
versus going to one of our very fine establishments in our area that have higher cost. If they elect to go to one of our clinics right. and have just a typical office visit, then that would go towards their deductible, which would impact their HSA account. So they can right. preserve those dollars in their HSA account by making better choices as far as where to access their care.
Right.
Yeah, I'd like to think it's rather than waiting till the end of the year to see if you behaved in a way that would get you this extra money, we just give it to you up front.
Yeah.
You get really the HSA money up front.
Give it to you up front?
Yeah.
Right. The districts, they do a quarterly drop. So let's just say that the contribution is going to be $2,400 for the year. They divide that new quarterly drops. I mean, it's a employer's decision when to do
your... Thank you. When I said up front, I mean, you get it regardless. Whether it comes quarterly, you're going to get the HSA amount if you participate in plan four.
And you're not having... I mean, it's not because you had to pay out something. It's about your choices. No,
it's that you avoided mm-hmm. through healthy choices.
Mm-hmm.
So it actually, that plan design really complements our wellness program and the other incentives, the reimbursement for fitness memberships, the reimbursement, the $50 debit card for going to get your annual wellness checkups. All of those incentives are in addition to the HSA plan.
Thanks.
Anyone else? Other questions?
Can you talk about the difference between people who do everything correctly, wellness-wise, and they make those healthy choices, versus an employee who is devastated with a bad diagnosis? They don't have a choice, necessarily, of where they want to go. You know where I'm going with this?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I want everybody to make healthy choices. We all do. But then there comes a time in your life when a child or a spouse or yourself, you've done everything correctly, but you're hit with something. Are they just kind of stuck? I mean, they have to go to a specialist. They have to have long treatment.
This is one of the reasons why we have multiple plan designs, because someone who is willing to pay the higher premium can access a plan number two, for example, which has richer benefits associated with it.
So our members need to say, okay, I'll go with plan two, it costs more, but just in case I get cancer, it'd be better if I had this plan. Is
that's
that
a personal choice, yeah.
It's a personal choice.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the ones who do our district a favor economically that go with plan four, if they have the same catastrophic thing happened to them, their coverage isn't
Well, that would be correct, but don't say they do a favor for us. They do a favor for themselves as well, because they have lower out-of-pocket.
No, I mean, with out-of-pocket, but with co-pays and everything else that goes up and up and up. I mean, those favors get balanced. So I'm just trying to figure out, if I were a family member and my five daughters were still at home, what plan would I take? Would I pay more, thinking, maybe?
That's each individual has a, tolerance for risk. And this is just like any other insurance. If you want to go with a $3,000 deductible, the premium's different than if you go with a $100 deductible.
I understand that.
And so every family has a willingness to accept different degrees of risk. Our plan designs allow for that. The other reality is that plan one is no longer affordable for anyone. And if you look at this is one of the reasons we provide the comparable school districts. The plan which has a $100 and $200 deductible and no coinsurance, which is what we had 5 years ago, is just not sustainable anymore.
No, I agree with that.
So we're continuing.
I'm just saying that also the reality is, as we have our people look at things, the families, and we all know who they are, we hear about our staff members, it's a hardship to take that cheaper price, but then to realize what happens if your family is thrust into a devastating situation. That's all. And I'm just asking about that. So when I look at all these figures, I understand them. I understand why you have choices. I've made choices too. My husband's on ACA. You know, he doesn't have insurance. We've all had to do this. But the costs are really extraordinary. And I think it just needs to be stated that when you make these changes, depending upon what your family's going through, it could be really tough times. And I'm just saying that not to say we should do anything differently, but to appreciate what it really means for families that hit those points. That's all.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yep.
Can a family, like, let's say they decide they don't know they're going to get cancer. You don't know what's going to happen in the future, and you decide to go with a less expensive plan because you typically live a healthy lifestyle and you try to make those, you know, decisions with using the most cost-effective care, and then something does happen. Is it possible to transition from plan to plan, or is there going to be some big issue with pre-existing that's going to limit you from being able to switch over into a higher cost?
Each year during the open enrollment period, the employees can make a plan election change. So the open enrollment period, we educate them on the three different plan options that are available for the new plan year that always starts on July 1st. So they have the availability to switch plans. I know when we've done the education each year during the open enrollment, a person maybe will select a more benefit-rich plan because they have a pending surgery they know about, or they have a pregnancy that they're planning for. So they maybe would want a more benefit-rich depending on what they think their exposure will be.
Okay.
But then the following year, they can switch to a different plan. So each year during open enrollment, an employee has the flexibility of selecting their plan for the year.
Okay.
The pre-exit you're referring to does not exist because they're covered under plan and they're just moving from plan to plan depending on their election at that time.
Yeah, because I would be worried about that.
No, there's no pre-exit.
Somehow there's this pre-existing thing that we're not going to allow you in this plan because we knew you have this cancer diagnosis.
No, absolutely not.
When is the open enrollment period?
The open enrollment period, I believe, defined by the district, well, it's usually 30 days prior to the renewal. However, we actually are starting education next week on just the direction of what we're offering or what we are proposing, just so they start understanding the differences between a traditional plan and an HSA plan.
Is there an exception to that open enrollment, like the beginning of the calendar year, you're in that phase of the year and, you know, something happens within the first 30 days? Get a diagnosis of cancer, is there an exception or a waiver or something to get into a different plan at that point?
No, there's not. There's what's referred to as qualifying event, and that would be a birth or adoption of a child, marriage, divorce, or legal separation, or change in a status that impacts your benefits, meaning let's just say you're covered under your spouse's plan, he works for an employer, they lose their plan, or he elects to change employers, that would allow them to join the plan within 30 days of that qualifying event. But a medical condition change is not considered a qualifying event.
Okay.
What Janice described does happen, in fact. That is, employees who know they're going to be facing medical costs migrate to the more benefit-rich plan for that year. What ends up happening then is that the loss ratio on those plans, because unhealthy people or people who are going to have high costs keep going to that plan, that premium for that plan is just going to keep going up and up and up. Because they're always choosing to go to that plan, which eventually will make that plan unaffordable, because the people who are always going there are the ones that have the highest costs. And so that premium will continue to go up relative to the others. And so understand that that's just a natural by choice phenomenon. Remember, the one thing that we do have some say over that impacts is the claims ratio or the loss ratio.
Okay.
Thank you.
More questions? Thank you very much. Next is the consent agenda items. Let's see. Are there any items on the consent agenda that you would like to have considered separately? If none, I would entertain a motion to approve the items on the consent agenda as presented.
Move.
A second?
I'll second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion to approve the consent agenda as presented, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, signify by saying nay. Motion passes. A board member report and discussion. I will call upon board members in the order of roll call. Sorry, I hit a button on my iPad and everything got huge. And I will ask you to present any comments or committee reports you have. Tim Mettinger.
Just a couple of quick things tonight. Reminder to everyone to get out and vote in the upcoming election here, which I believe is a week from tomorrow. And I just want to thank everyone, guests, and everyone who came out to the meeting tonight. And always great to see people here. Certainly appreciate that. And I know that for many it was not a work day, so appreciate their coming out as well. So thanks for everyone in attendance tonight.
Okay, thank you. Gary Dunlap.
The thing I have to say is that the DECA group took a bunch of kids to New York City this over Easter. My granddaughter was one of them, and they made it back home with most of the kids.
I hope they're all here.
Now they got back and they had a great time. Everything went great. So
excellent. Good.
Okay, thank you. Tom Cruise.
Nothing. I'll let Lisa highlight the thing you talked about today.
I think they pretty much said it all. I appreciate their work on that.
Yeah, it was, if anything, it was just I was impressed that these guys are trying their hardest, I think, so.
Thank you. Jeff Young?
I hope everyone had a good Easter or spring break. And school year is now 3/4 over, so everyone should finish the last term strong. That's about it.
Okay, thank you. Kate Mayer?
Nothing.
All right.
I know,
Lisa
that's
Collins?
A surprise, isn't it?
Huge.
Gary's he's checking my temperature.
Ooh. Lisa Collins?
No, I don't. I'm tired.
Sorry.
I can go home.
All right. And I will echo Tim's comment about voting a week from tomorrow. And I just wanted to offer my condolences to the Green family. Two of our staff members lost their dad on Saturday. So my condolences on the loss of their father, Gary Green. My thoughts go out to them. And that's all I have. Also, you have received correspondence and school board committee written reports. You have the meeting schedule. April 12th, we will have a board meeting, originally scheduled for the 11th, but the 12th is a Tuesday. So take special note of that. April 19th is a Region 6 new school board member gathering at CESA 4 in West Salem at 7 p.m. April 25th is the board annual organizational meeting. Tim will be at home watching it, I'm sure.
Sure.
He'll come to the meetings, I'm sure.
Oh, I hope not.
And then board review of policies and administrative rules, Student Achievement and Learning Committee, anything you need to talk about there, Kate?
No, not really. It's pretty much updates to...
Okay, updates.
State bylaws, yep.
Okay. In that case, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
I would so move.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none?